Natural Fitness Laboratory. Living and coaching natural fitness through clean, oxygen-fed sport. What is trail running? Trail running, as loosely defined, is the closest thing to all-terrain running in a natural environment. From a dirt road or single track, to route finding on a mountain, essentially everything goes. A good trail runner needs to have proficiency in nearly all other running disciplines. Other forms of running often have certain conditions or objectives in mind. Let's take a moment to compare and contrast what every type of running has to offer. This is also the preferred order to train someone into the sport of trail running. Running track is the most clinical running discipline. Every runner has to spend time on the track working on perfect technique. It is a sterile and controlled environment, which permits introspection of breathing, form, flow, stride, and tempo. The pacing, grade, and surface on the track are constant, whereas nature is variable. Road racing begins to introduce more variance in the course and conditions, including having to run with other people. It is also the most popular form of running. Cross-country running does not have to be on grass fields, but it often is. There are some hills and uneven terrain, which begins to demand a wider range of cardiomuscular conditioning. The spikes used in cross-country running do not work in a trail environment. Fell running is like cross-country with water obstacles, mud, and fences thrown in. Sometimes like a steeplechase on steroids. I think the objective is to see how many people can lose their shoes. The mountain running racing format has developed into a straight uphill run to the top, followed sometimes by a rapid descent. The emphasis is on the athlete's climbing ability, quads and lungs, rather than the constant technique change-ups required in a trail running race. Here, you will learn pacing. There is a subtle difference between mountain running and road running. On a trail, there is a correlation between high heart rate and a small stride, usually climbing steep hills. Conversely, on the roads, there is a coupling of high heart rate with a long stride. Ensure that you train all intensities on both road and trail so that you don't condition yourself to just one mechanical cardio relationship. Orienteering, trekking, and adventure running take running off trails and over rough terrain. Practice flexibility, agility, ground feeling, and problem solving. Gradually increase your speed completely off trail, and thereafter all trails will seem trivial. Parkour techniques were developed as the means to run over difficult natural terrain. I learned how to clear obstacles like trees, large rocks, mud, roots, streams, jump from height, and tackle extreme pitches. Use nature to improve your cardiovascular and muscular fitness with particular attention to agility and coordination.
Hi, I'm Ray Zahab. I'm an adventurer and endurance athlete. Also, did a high impact sport, and again, that term high impact sounds so bad and it's given to running, but anyhow, an impact sport such as running increases our bone density, among other things. For the runners out there, and I know you will be able to understand this, after a very stressful day, or a day when you feel lousy, or a day you feel terrible, you hit those trails, you hit that road, and you get out there for a run. Nothing makes you feel as good as that run, no matter how long it is. You get out there and run and it clears your mind. Again, there's that mental health. Nothing makes you feel as good as a run.
Why trail run? Do you want to remain a prisoner of pavement when you can free yourself from the roads and engage in a richer and more enduring experience? Running on forest trails is an all-season, all-terrain, all-natural, clean, oxygen-rich experience for both the body and soul. It combines the essential elements of life including sun, oxygen, gravity, and motion. Humans have evolved over millions of years to run ultra distances across natural terrain, not to sit behind a desk or to work out in a sterile gym. Our minds and bodies are wired for nature and respond best to that training environment. Running is simply the most efficient, practical, natural means of achieving fitness. Add the natural aesthetics of the trail, and we can run further at greater intensity with less physical and mental fatigue.
But what's so interesting about trail running that's a little bit different than even being on the road is trail running requires you to use various muscle groups in your body at various times. The terrain is very dynamic, it's always changing. So the muscles in your hips, your quads, your hamstrings, your glutes, your core is functioning differently than it would on a more symmetrical road run. Trail running has benefits, incredible benefits, in that these other muscle groups are activated more often while trail running. Is it good cross training? You know, that's a great question. You look at some fantastic cyclists around the world, the road cyclists, and when the cyclocross season comes, they're running with their bikes. And of course, cyclocross takes place off-road. For mountain bikers, the same thing. Many of my friends who race at a fairly elite level will actually get out and do some trail runs. But I think the most interesting cross-training, if you will, are elite road runners that take on trail running as a way of getting out, taxing their aerobic system differently. Provides a completely, completely different workout. Truth be told, when the summer comes, I love nowhere else to be than on the trails and getting most of my mileage done on the trails where we live.
In terms of fitness, it is a concentrated total body workout which develops power endurance, agility, balance, and core strength to degrees that you can just not achieve indoors or on the roads. It is the practical application of all your core strength and conditioning. A trail will induce far more natural intervals than could a structured workout. This diversity provides a much better training effect than running on a treadmill like a gerbil. Compared with running on city sidewalks, the variety of single-track trails that you will discover in the forest will greatly enhance your dynamic range in cardiovascular zones. You can run a different route every day and never get bored. Even the same trail changes with the conditions. Negotiating a windy, hilly, narrow footpath at speed creates real-time problem-solving opportunities. Trail running is about mental fitness too. The variety of footing, pace, and stride in trail running will add longevity to your running career. Put some fun into your run. What could be cooler than you and your friends being covered from head to foot in mud? First steps. To a neophyte, trails may be intimidating. Rocks, roots, mud, and steep descents can test the nerves whilst the climbs challenge the heart, lungs, and legs. Technical trails can be a seasoned track star's kryptonite.
Someone who's never tried trail running before and is a bit apprehensive to for fear of twisting an ankle or the hills being too big or the downhills being too steep, what I always say, find somebody who's an experienced trail runner or go with friends that have gone before. Go with someone who's willing to take the time to show you some technique so that you can better enjoy trail running. The biggest misconception is that trail running is too hard to do. Or that it's dangerous. Truly, it is not. Once you learn the basics of trail running technique, staying relaxed, not wasting energy and expending too much energy trying to go up, or for that matter, trying to go down, you want to stay relaxed on that too. Then trail running actually becomes so enjoyable. It's such a great alter to running always on the road. But my first piece of advice is, hey, again, never be too proud to ask. Never be too proud. That's my first trail runs who were done with friends of mine who were patient with me. I was much slower, and they went out with me trail running, and I was able to enjoy with them and learn some of the techniques that I could go out and take part in trail running and my own piece of wilderness here where I live, alone sometimes in that solitude of trail running.
Let's address the biggest concerns right away. Most people are worried about injury, specifically twisting an ankle, tackling spine-tingling downhills and lung-bursting climbs, coordinating their way through rocks, roots, and mud without looking like a marionette, or having the right equipment. You have a much greater chance succumbing to overuse injuries from repetitively running on hard pavement than injuring yourself on the trails. People do fall in the woods, but they only make a sound if others are there to hear them. You will be amazed at what people can safely run down. With smart, progressive training and commitment, start slowly on easy terrain while maintaining good running form and a full stride. Gradually increase the difficulty. Eventually, all stones, rivers, and logs will disappear beneath your feet. The technical secret of trail running is maintaining good form and fluidity. Let's start with some basic drills before covering survival skills on more difficult terrain. Drills and exercises. Warm up on the flats before you begin a trail run. Go through a full range of motion in all joints. Hold off on the full stretch until later that evening. Sufficient practice of good running form on flat and smooth surfaces now will transfer to more difficult terrain later on. We want you to be able to run trails as if you were on a road. You will never be faster on the trails than you are on the track. Conversely, to get faster off-road, you need to get faster on-road. I won't go into a lot of detail as to how to run around a track or on the roads. There are plenty of excellent books and videos which explain good running form. What I can tell you is that you might be able to get away with questionable technique in a long road race, but good fundamental skills are imperative to handling technical off-road conditions. The most significant issues that haunt runners before they even get onto trails are posture, arm position and motion, stride components and length, foot strike position, and elasticity and quickness of the push. What you want to do is lead forward from the hips while standing tall with good back posture. The angle of the spine should align with the bend in the legs. The arms should swing back and forth with the hands and forearm inside the circle scribed by the elbow. The arm swing should be powered by the shoulders and core muscles. The elbows need to be pulled back to their full range of motion. The shoulders should be seated in the joint. The hands must remain relaxed. The common mistakes are to see the arms swinging down by the pockets, out to the sides, too forward of the body line, or the arms cross the center line. Many people stop using their arms completely on hills or in difficult terrain. This is really where you must use the power and tempo of your arms to see you through the difficult sections. There are a couple of issues that show up all the time when it comes to the legs. Either runners tippy-toe around, over and on every obstacle, or they smear the ground with prolonged lumbering strides. A running stride should spend a fraction of time in the ground and most of the time in the air. You should lead with the knee. Extend so that the midfoot strikes the ground under the knee. Pull back and kick up. The force vector of the foot push should be towards the rear right from the initial strike. Imagine rolling a treadmill underneath yourself. Your footsteps should be nearly silent. If you don't want to twist an ankle, make sure you maintain good form. Roll forward over your big toe, push off, and kick your heels up. Here are some drills that may help to teach better form and fluidity. The most fundamental running drills are referred to as ABCs. These exercises emphasize a high knee initiation, plus a full and quick completion of the stride. Lean forward from the hips while standing tall. Kicking the heels up will quicken and lighten your step. Correct foot alignment. Make the push far more dynamic and powerful. Now try some skipping and trotting. This movement shows up a lot during a run, especially when it is more natural or safer to switch legs over an obstacle than to stride over it. Shuttle runs work directional changes and accelerations. Drop your weight in the direction you want to go by releasing and bending your legs. Sounds simple enough, but many people are too stiff to facilitate quick direction changes and momentum. The crossover exercises help coordination. You will be surprised how often your legs will cross over each other in the trails. It is best to get the feel for this in a controlled setting before finding yourself in an awkward position later on.
Twisting ankles is one of the most common questions, believe it or not, that I'm asked about whenever I give a talk. Have you ever twisted? Did you twist your ankles in the sand, in the Sahara? Did you twist your ankles in the mountains of the Gobi Desert? Dragging that sled to the South Pole, going over lumpy frozen snow, did you twist your ankle? Believe it or not, my answer is no. When I first started trail running, I tell my friends, taught me how to stay relaxed and go over terrain nice and smoothly, there was a bit of tension in my body, and yes, I twisted my ankles. But to be perfectly honest with you, and knock on wood, running across the entire Sahara Desert, 7,500 kilometers, we never seriously twisted our ankles. We just became very relaxed, and in that great distance, we're able to stay relaxed to a point when the terrain got a bit tricky and know that that won't happen. When you get out and you run on trails your first few times, getting out there, truly being able to relax and enjoy the experience, be wary of your surroundings. But if you try to fight the terrain that you're on, my friend Dave taught me this a long time ago about running downhill. Don't try to fight the terrain. Pretend your water going over rocks. And that analogy worked really well for me, and you'll find the analogy that works for you. But for me, being able to just stay relaxed, I'm sure, is one of the keys in preventing a twisted ankle. It's very rare to come out and twist your ankle.
Most people aim to step on every obstacle, resulting in a sputtering stride. Instead, ignore all the irrelevant hazards. Maintain a full stride and clear them in the air. If you have good form, you can land on anything. The way to train this is to concentrate on striding out, first on easy terrain, then progress slowly on more challenging terrain. Think form first. Be quick and light on your feet. Avoid smearing the ground heel to toe. This will slow you down, tire your muscles, and make you more susceptible to tripping. You are safe while you are in the air. It is during contact with the earth that bad things can happen. All the force should be focused in a quick, dynamic push, which takes advantage of the elasticity in your legs. This leaves most of the stride for recovery. Relaxation is key. Completely, from ankles all the way up to head. Relax and use gravity to power motion. Relax to absorb shocks, prevent injuries, and relax in order to feel the terrain underfoot. Remember that stiff shocks deliver a bumpy ride. Lead your motion with deep, conscious breathing. The whole body's center, including the diaphragm and core, should initiate and drive locomotion. Be kinesthetically aware of your center of momentum and the fall line of the terrain. This will come in handy when aligning where you are naturally headed and where the trail goes. Maintain tempo through all obstructions or changes in direction. Just like mountain biking, keep pedaling. Keep your heels up, especially in mud. Propulsion will get you through nearly anything. Without it, you will have no ability to steer or determine your fate, like floating down a river without a paddle. The same concept applies to cornering. drop your center of gravity by relaxing the legs. Lean into the turn with your hips. Look up and around the corner to completion and accelerate. You do the turn. Don't let the trail turn you. Look where you want to go, not at your feet. Plan ahead and look as far ahead as you can. Glance down if you must, but consciously bring yourself to focus up on the trail. Similarly, anticipate where you will be, not where you are. On downhills especially, identify the fall line, the direction that water would flow, and head the same way whenever possible. It is always safer and quicker not to fight gravity. It often wins. Pacing, tempo, and form is often difficult to maintain given changing conditions imposed upon us by trail running. Always readjust. When it comes to potentially twisting ankles, tripping, or falling, the key is not to panic. Stay relaxed and continue your stride to recover. If it gets too hairy, pop up in the air and regard proper form before running on. Skip a stride if you have to for the sake of control. If there is a stream or ditch, it is sometimes safer to step in it than to overreach precariously with a stride. Some things need to be jumped. Lead aggressively in and out of the jump. Punch the opposite arm and leg forward together. Recompose yourself in the air so that you land on a bent leg in the ideal position under your center of momentum, one which is counterbalanced with the opposite arm. The biggest mistake people make is landing flat-footed, overextended, straight-legged, leaning back with their arms flailing. Hills pose particular challenges to a runner. There are common areas of focus whether you are climbing or descending a hill. Lower your center of gravity so that you can achieve greater stability and longer stride length. As a consequence, deeper angles are created at your ankles and knee joints. The arms become very important in contributing to propulsion, maintaining tempo, and providing steerage. Lean forward from the hips. Give more emphasis to your core and hips and glutes as the prime movers, breathing deeply, and use the diaphragm as a running muscle. Associate breathing deeply with enjoyment. Work with, not against, gravity. Traction can be a concern ascending and descending. Lower your heel more on uphills if required. On a downhill, lead forward and adjust your foot strike so that it is not breaking or shearing. And perpetual motion of the arms and legs and breathing will help you through most difficult terrain. Uphills place a heavy tax on the cardiovascular system, quadriceps, and calf muscles, whereas downhills demand plyometric power in the legs, core strength, and, surprisingly, an anaerobic component if you go fast enough. Now, let's tackle climbing. Lean forward into the hill with the hips. Keep a good posture in the spine and look up the hill. Quicken and shorten your stride just enough to stay within an optimal power zone. Use the legs like gears on a car. Too low a gear and you will race the engine. Too high a gear and you will stall out. Start thinking about using the big muscles in your hips rather than the small joints and muscles at the extremities. Remember to pump your arms. Focus even more towards pushing from hips and the core. At a certain point, you may need to lower your tempo and lengthen your stride as you transition into Nordic ski walking. At this point, it's all about striding out. Remember to return to a normal running stride, form, and tempo when you crest the hill. Many people stand up and stall out when they encounter an obstacle, such as a large rock on an uphill. Instead, bend your leg, lean into the object, and project your hips forward and over. Keep the same level over the ground. The earth is rising up to meet you with every step. The greatest threat to good form that regular runners have when climbing steep hills is that they compress or collapse onto the hill with their spine, rather than running tall while leaning up the hill. Downhills require commitment. Envision where your momentum will carry you. Lean down the fall line. Lower your center of gravity and lengthen your stride. Resist the urge to step on everything. Keep your legs bent. Let gravity bring you down to earth rather than reaching for a landing. Pump your arms to maintain control and reduce foot impact. Absorb the impact in the hips. The trick is to stay totally relaxed from ankles through the legs and to the upper body. This will permit you to use gravity to power motion, absorb the shocks, prevent injuries, and feel the changing terrain. Consciously and forcefully exhale with each impact as you tighten the core, very much like the anti-G drills of a fighter pilot. Rocks or sharp drops are handled best by pre-jumping. Relax and bend your leg just before the drop. Keep your legs retracted and let gravity guide you down to the ground. Land on a bent leg. Be prepared to be pitched forward immediately upon landing. To reduce this effect, project decisively forward with your upper body just before the obstacle. It is easier to fly over obstacles than to land on them. Most times, it is best to ignore them. Going straight down a hill is relatively easy. Changing direction away from the fall line is more challenging. Look ahead. Plan the turn by envisioning where your momentum will naturally want to carry you. Lower your center of gravity as you approach the turn. Look where you want to go in advance. Lean into and project around the turn. Follow your line of sight. Accelerate out of the turn with your legs and arms. There is an optimum speed for a steep downhill. The sweet spot is when you are descending at close to the same trajectory as the angle of the slope. At this point, there is minimal impact. You will have more control running down the hill than falling, sliding, or braking. The easiest way to learn this is using a downhill progression. Choose an easy hill. Try it while arresting the natural motion or pull of gravity. Finish off by accelerating down the hill. Feel a difference? Move on to a steeper hill when you're ready.
You'll notice something really cool happen as you start to progress in your trail running program. The more trail running you do, you're actually able to think sort of autopilot as you're running over things. I first learned this mountain biking. I had a very hard time with technical mountain biking. I always seemed to be putting the brakes on. I always seemed to be afraid to go over things. I was overthinking my terrain. The interesting thing with trail running is a similar thing can happen. But with trail running, things seem to happen at a different rate because your feet are in contact with the ground. Remember I talked about water over rocks? Eventually, with more experience and more mileage, your body eventually becomes accustomed and your mind to not even thinking about the terrain, almost thinking subconsciously about the terrain that you're running over. So as you approach rocks or roots, rather than thinking I'm going to hurt myself over those rocks or I'm going to twist my ankle over a root, you'll find yourself being able to negotiate the terrain without any risk of injury and even be able to do it after a while on autopilot. And that's because as we become more familiar with the types of terrain that we're running on, we become more comfortable. The more comfortable we become, the less we overthink it. The greatest trail running experiences I've had have come while running in some very technical terrain where I'm being tested with my endurance and I'm really pushing it. But it's such a great feeling. It's exhilarating. And some of the trails we have at home are very steep. They'll have long climbs. You get to the top and you think you're so exhausted. You go down over the side and those roots and rocks and you're actually feeling better. You're recovering as you descend over these things. You're not disassociated with the terrain you're on. You're in total association. But your legs are just picking up and going over. As smooth as that river is, cascading down those rocks, you're cascading down your downhill section of your trail.
Core strength is vitally important to trail running, particularly on descents. The lumbar stabilizers and transverse abdominis contract to form a supportive sheath around the spine and brace for impact. They are the linchpin for stability and linkage between the upper and lower body. It is through the core that power is transferred. So it is important to strengthen the transverse and obliques, as well as exercising the big muscles, like rectus abdominis. Spend up to half your time perfecting techniques on the roads. Running the flats will condition your body to stride out at high intensities. Start the season with easy trails. Avoid running too fast downhill too early. By mid-season, alternate intensity on hard and easy trails so you build both power and speed endurance. Pick a flatter trail for long, slow distance and recovery days. Practice the hardest routes on the trail, but race the shortest lines.
You know, I honestly believe running heals the body. Running is one of the best things for your body. I think that running is very natural. It's a natural form of movement. And this whole philosophy of natural fitness, getting out and enjoying the outdoors, and using sports like running, Nordic skiing, any sport that connects you closer to with nature is one of the most, or it might be, the best way for our bodies and our minds to get into shape. Running has got to be one of the most natural movements of the human body. Of course, we live lives where we sit a lot. If we were to all of a sudden get up from our desks and start running enormous mileage, well, of course we're gonna get injured. But if we take a sensible training program and we build ourselves with our mileage, I believe that running is one of the best forms of training, again, for the body and for the mind and for overall conditioning. Running has to be one of the most natural movements that the human body can perform. We've created an industry, it would seem, out of the assumption that once we get running, we're gonna get injured. So we go into it mentally from that perspective that, well, it's gotta be bad for my knees, it's gotta be bad for my hips. Too much running is just simply not good for me. Again, I say, going back to a sensible training program, allowing your body to adapt, running is probably the best prescription.
Trail running is even more amazing, if not safer, when you are running with a group. Join us at the Natural Fitness Lab for weekly group trail runs. We mentor thousands of runners towards more advanced skills and fitness through clinics and personal coaching. Happy trails.